of y'all give you fellowship for a little longer? I'm much rather for that to be happening than for me to try to encourage you. Come on, go bring somebody. Go talk to somebody. Smile while you do it. I'm glad that y'all did it. Amen. 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 We're doing part two, and some of this you heard last week, and so if you heard last week, that means you were bold enough to come back. Amen. I'm going to share some things, and again, we're going to have some fun with it, and I want you all to listen to this message today. Hopefully, it will pretty much let you know why God has called me to do messages like this. We need to understand that the Word of God is given to us. And again, it's not given to us just to memorize a little story so that we can say, oh, I tell you, we just love the Word of God. If you love it, do it.
Amen.
Jesus said this, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. That's what Jesus said. Amen.
Amen.
So he's not talking about read it, sing it, and talk about it. He said, do it. Mm-hmm. So let me show this scripture to you once again, and I'm going to do it this way. I'm going to break it down. It says, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable. So profitable means what? How many of y'all heard last week? Advantageous. I'm so glad I was here last week. Man, I remembered it. But it's advantageous. You know, now when we say profitable, we're not talking about money. Amen? But it's profitable, it's advantageous. And it's for doctrine. Doctrine is nothing but teaching. And reproof, that means to reprimand. It's for correction, that means to make adjustments. Amen? Instruction in righteousness, which means learning to accept our right standing in Christ. Not our right standing in works, but right standing in Christ. Not because of what we have done. It's because of what he has done. And he declared us righteous. And I'm not going to argue it. I'm not going to argue and say, I don't feel righteous. If he said you have to feel it before it happens, then that's one thing. But I don't have to feel it. Amen?
Amen.
But he declared me righteous. No more than when I found out that I was born a sinner. I didn't have anything to do with that either. That was Adam. But that was passed down to us in our genes. And Jesus came and regened us. Regeneration. Regene. That's what that means. So we've been regenerated. Amen?
Amen.
Not degenerated. But regenerated. So, again, some of this, like I said, I covered last time. The New Living Testament says this. God used it to prepare and equip his people. Whose people? To do what? The Living Bible says this. It is God's way of making us well prepared at every point, fully equipped to do good to everyone. The CEV Bible, the Contemporary English Version, says the Scriptures train God's servants to do all kinds of good deeds. Folks, even though we have not been saved by works, we have been saved to perform good works.
Amen.
In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 through 10, Paul writes to the church of Ephesus, "For by grace ye are saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." But verse 10 says this, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto what?"
Good works.
Unto what?
Good works.
I can't hear you. Unto what?
Good works.
Which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. The New Living Testament says this, "For we are God's masterpiece." He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things he planned for us a long time ago. So he planned us to work and stuff for us to do, and then he brought us on the scene to do what he planned for us to do. Church is not Coming to church is not serving God. Coming to church is to learn to serve. When we go out of here, that's why the world don't recognize the church, because when we leave here, we try to blend in instead of stand out. Because we don't want to be persecuted, yet Paul says all those who will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. So we are loud in the church and quiet in the communities. Because we don't want to cause, we don't want any attention to be brought to ourselves. And so we don't have many good works. And when you talk to people, say, well, what have you been doing for the Lord? Oh, I go to church every Sunday.
Yeah.
And so we actually have come to the realization that, or we think we've come to the realization that God is pleased because we go to church. So I know I'm going to heaven. Why? Because I haven't missed a day. I haven't missed a day. It's almost like I don't miss a day at work. And we boast about attendance. Now, I want you to keep your attendance up, because this is for to hear the word of God. But it's not just to hear the word.
Amen.
God gave us principles. And these godly principles are tools to repair what's broken in our lives. Did that help you?
Amen.
See, we're under renovation. Y'all have to do this. Transformation, renovation, regeneration. That means that when we came to Christ, we were tore up from the floor. We were dead in our sins and trespasses. But God, who loved us in spite of. Amen? And so what he's doing now, he's restoring us back to where we have fallen. And many of us don't realize that we have fallen a long way. So God is working through us by his Spirit. And what he's doing is he is allowing us to participate in this journey that we are on. Not spectating. So we have to use these tools that God has given us to help repair these areas in our lives. Because we have some wrong thinking. Amen. Our thinking has been programmed by the world. And so we need to repair that. We need to uproot that. We need to change the way we think about things, about people, about each other. We need to change stuff that's not working in our lives and say, we need to find out, what does God say we need to do? We can't just keep doing something and, you know, well, it's all I know. But that's what you're here for. I'm trying to give you some more tools. Amen. A tool, folks, what we said last week. Tools, anything used as a means of accomplishing a task or a purpose. It's an instrument. An instrument is anything used in doing a certain work for producing a certain result, especially such as requiring delicacy, accuracy, and precision. So these are what tools are for. And many of us have these tools. We take it home, many of us have several of these books, these instruction books. Amen.
Amen.
It's almost like you have something and you never read the instructions, but you buy something and you go home and you're trying to repair it or put it together, assemble it, and you never look at the instructions. And God is saying, I'm trying to show you how to repair some things in your life, to repair your thinking, to redo some things in your life. But we never read the instructions. And when we come to church, we don't really expect to learn. Many of us come to feel. We come to have a good time and you know, enjoy the fellowship. We should have a good time. We should enjoy the fellowship. But my main purpose of coming to church has always been to learn. I mean, I like all the other stuff. I do. Don't get me wrong. But my main purpose is to learn. Amen. Because I feel like if I don't learn, you know, I feel like, it was okay, it was all that, but I didn't learn nothing. And I want to learn something. I want something I can apply. So we must be equipped and trained in how to properly use our kingdom tools, which is God's Word. Alright? We must be equipped and trained on how to properly use our kingdom tools, which is the Word of God. Now, in Ecclesiastes chapter 10, talked a little bit about this last time. If the iron be blunt and he do not whet the edge, then must he put to more strength. But wisdom is profitable to direct. Now, that sounds a little weird, but in the Amplified, it's a little clearer. It says, if the axe is dull and he does not sharpen his edge, then he must exert more strength. But wisdom to sharpen the axe helps him succeed with less effort. Now, that seems like that's just common sense, but sometimes people don't get it. They don't realize that God gives us an edge. God gives us an advantage, but we don't take advantage of the edge he has given us. So we walk around dull of hearing, dull of practicing the word of God, and so we kind of fit with the world instead of being sharp. When you fail to stay sharp, you have to exert more force. You have to stay sharp. You have to stay on your game. Amen? See, and that means we're going to have to put forth effort. So I said last week that we are not limited by lack of inspiration, but in preparation, application, and perspiration. Amen. We don't like to perspire. We don't want to work hard. We don't want to go through anything. And I'm saying that that's part of your training, folks. It's all in the Bible. All in the Bible. In my prayer, I quote it. For all those who will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. How many of y'all have read that? Amen. So you can't avoid it if you're going to live godly. Now, we're ready to have some fun. Y'all ready?
Yes.
Okay. So, there are things that we have adopted in our lives that have become what I like to say, our philosophy. These are cliches that's been passed down. Many of us don't even know where the cliches even begun, but we use them and sometimes we adopt them and we make it a part of our thinking. And we never challenge, did that make sense? Just because somebody who we respect and love, did that mean that it makes sense? And is it for us today? So let me give you some of these. And keep in mind now, all traditional cliches are not negative, but you got to beware of useless Christian, or not Christian, but traditional cliches. Beware of them, and I'm not going to even try to change your thinking on this, but I'm going to share some things with you that you have heard. Many of you have heard these. Now, some of our younger folks may not have heard a lot of these, but I will guarantee you, some of the stuff I'm about to show, you have heard this. You probably said it, and you may have adopted it as part of your philosophy, your way of living, your way of thinking. Y'all ready?
Yes.
All right. How many of y'all ever heard this one?
Yeah.
Read that with me on three. One, two, three, read.
You can't teach a whole wrong through the truth.
Now, I don't know if you agree with that or not. You may agree with that. You may say, oh, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. You might say it's true. You may say you agree with it. You may say, but then what about this one right here? You're never too old to learn. That kind of cancels out what you just read.
Right.
I mean, I've never heard them too.
Yeah.
So which one do you believe? They compete against each other. They don't complete each other. So some people say, well, you know you can't teach an old dog a trick. Oh, you're never too old to learn. And you know when they talk about old dogs, they're not talking about dogs per se, they're talking about people. They say when you get old, you don't change. I say, you people, everybody has the potential to change. But everybody doesn't have the same passion to change. Because if you don't see the purpose of changing, you're not going to change. Especially if you like what you, the way you are, even though it's not helping you or fulfilling you. So some people say, well, I've got too old to change. Not necessarily. Only time you can't change is when you need
it. Amen.
Long as you are alive, it just takes more effort because you get to a point where there are certain comfort levels that you like. There are certain philosophies you've been living by, and you say, well, you know, this is what we've always been this way. We've always done it this way. Y'all ever heard it before?
Yes.
So what if it's not working? Well, I mean, it's okay. I mean, my grandfather done it, and his father done it. And so what we do, we take things and we take it into our lives, and it become a part of our psyche. It become a part of our lifestyle. And the stuff maybe is obsolete, it's I don't know what. You know, it's about as much as me going and buying a pick for my head. No Afro picks? If someone's going to try to sell me a comb, what are you doing about a comb? What are you? Just because, you know, back in the day when I had something to pick out, I don't have nothing to pick out no more. So that don't mean that the same thing I used years ago is necessary for today. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
How many of y'all ever heard it? Read it on three. One, two, three, read.
All of the good and bad, y'all.
So all of the old folks in here saying that we're not good. You notice I included me. Right? Because if that's the case, where Brother Henry at? No, I'm teasing Brother Henry. Henry's a good brother, right?
Right.
So they proved that that don't work. Some of y'all get it, some of y'all don't. I tell you what happened before, I'm picking on some people. Don't laugh too hard, I might pick on you, Virginia. How about this? Read the long three, one, two, three, read. I'll cross that bridge when I get to it. And so you have a lot of people become reactive and not proactive. And the people that's proactive are running circles around the people who are waiting on something to happen. Then you got people watching things happen. So you got three kinds of people. You got those who watch things happen, those who make things happen, and those who wonder what happened. You got a few more. On three, breathe.
Sticks and stones may break my bones.
How many of you ever had your feeling hurt by something someone said? Raise your hand if you have. How can that be true? Sticks and stones, and sometimes you'd rather have sticks and stones than the word. Because sometimes the sticks and stones will leave bruises and cuts, but you can hear, sometimes those words go deep. And the thing about it is that they don't leave a mark down the inside. But there are some people that, well, you know, sticks and stones may break my bones. But words will never hurt me. Not true. What about this one? On three. One, two, three, ring. How about this one here? On three, ring. One, two, three, ring. That's a cliche. You may not have heard, but that's a cliche. Man, shoot. See, when you come from different backgrounds, different cultures, there are people who have fed into you certain things. It's like two people who are married. They come from different cultures, and one will feel one way, another will feel another way. Say, for example, if a person says, let's say if a person is married to a female married to a man, and he feels like this, shoot, I ain't working hard. Only fools and horses work. Okay? And she feels like this, oh, I work never killed anyone. How many other about that? See, you have different philosophies, you have different cultures, you have different cliches, and you gotta find out, am I gonna live by these cliches, these traditional cliches been passed down to me, or am I gonna live by the word of God? If any man be in Christ, he is in what? Do you know a new creation calls for new ways? It's a new way of life, so you're gonna have to retool. Amen. You got to stop thinking the way you're thinking. Hallelujah. What about this? Once a thief, always. You know, once a thief, always a thief. Then we're saying that there is no redemptive work in Christ. But you hear people saying stuff. And some people have made that their philosophy, their way of living, and they actually believe that. But yet still, you say, well, I thought you were saved. I am. Well, you were a sinner. Oh, that we talking about. No. If you cannot believe that a thief can be redeemed, what makes you think that you can be redeemed? Amen. Amen. Too much stuff. That's why you struggle when you're trying to talk to people and you keep hitting the barrier. You keep hitting this wall. And the reason why you hit this wall has everything to do with a culture or a way of thinking that someone came out of. And so here you are, you say, well, we need to do better. You know, you're talking to your spouse or you're talking to whoever, and you talk to people in the church and say, listen, we need to do better. They got a certain way that they think, and I don't care what you say, they're not going to change. They're not. Unless they make up their mind that God's way is the best way. Yes. How many of y'all have heard this? On three, read that. One, two, three. What does that mean? What does it mean? What does ignorance is bliss mean? Yeah, happy? If you live by that, don't move next to me. I don't agree with that. According to my Bible, God says my people are destroyed for ignorance because of ignorance. Yeah. Here's one. I know y'all like this one. This, on three, read. One, two, three, read. I've heard a lot of people say it. What you don't know won't hurt. and actually live by that. Y'all don't think people live by this stuff?
Yeah.
I know it's not true, but it's someone who's not here that live by this stuff. What you don't know won't hurt. All that don't kill you make you stronger. Ignorance is bliss. It's amazing. And so when you're trying to talk to people, and especially now, again, I'm not talking about you, I'm just talking to you, I'm talking with you. People who are lazy, they never want to hear anything about working, about changing, about doing better. They never want to hear anything like that. All they want to hear is giving an excuse to stay in the condition that they're in. And they find some cliches to agree with what they want to do, because it makes them feel comfortable. And it makes them feel pretty, kind of feel justified in remaining the same. On three, I want you to read this.
Okay.
How many of y'all believe it? You hear that in the gym, right? No pain, no gain. Can I tell you something? When you are training, pain represents injury. Now you may get sore, but that's a difference. You get injured, you ain't gaining nothing. Uh-oh, here we go. 1, 3. Read this one. 1, 2, 3. There are people who philosophy is like that. And I was telling the leaders this morning, I didn't look up all of these, but I looked up the etymology of this particular phrase. And it was directed, I think they said, the person who wrote this began in 1977. It seemed like it's been around, like it's been around longer than that, right? And it was talking about the government. And it said the government was spending a lot of time and a lot of money on things that wasn't broke. And there was a lot of things that was broke, and it should be taking time and spending their time and effort and energy into things that really need fixing. And so this is how this originated. And so you have people who say that, you know, well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Which means that if it needs improving, you're not going to improve it because you feel like long as it's doing okay, I'm not going to. So if your refrigerator starts making a strange noise, you gonna wait for it to break down? No, really. If your car, and you hear a noise that you never heard in your car, are you gonna wait until it stops? And most of the time, when cars break down, you know, it break down on roads that nobody ought to travel on. And it's raining at 3 o'clock in the morning, just about when your phone died. And then whoever say, well, what happened? I don't know. Well, you see, I was making a funny noise. How long have you heard it? Oh, not long, maybe 3 months. What? It started about 3 months ago, something like that. You know how people, so you're saying, well, it ain't broke, it's getting me where I want to go. And there are some people that live like that. How about this on three? 1, 2, 3, read. Y'all ever heard that before?
Yes.
There are people who don't want to fly. They don't want to get on no plane. But they're driving a car. God didn't give you no wheels. You don't have no tires. All I'm doing is I'm challenging these traditions. If you live by that, that's why there's always these blocks, these ropes. We can't get no farther than that because you have made this a permanent block in your life. If God wanted me to fly, he would have given me wings. If God wanted me to be prosperous, he would have made me prosperous. If God didn't want me to be sick, he would have blocked me from eating all that pork. I'm telling you, you all think I'm making this stuff up. I've been pastoring for a while. I have heard all, well, Pastor, how come when I went to go get this car and God knew that I didn't have the funds to buy this car, how come he just didn't block it? I have actually heard that said to me one time. Why would God, knowing that I couldn't afford this car, why would he have me to buy it? Why would he know? Allow me to buy it. You know, being a pastor, you can't be where... So you kind of got to gotta have a straight face. You know what I'm talking about. You got to be... And I was young pastor, too. I'm going to tell you what I wanted to do. I wanted to say, are you all... No, not. But I kind of just, well... But I actually had that happen to me. Couldn't even pay the sales tax.
What?
Couldn't even get the license. And then, on top of that, the same person told me, when they realized, after about having the car for, I think, about a month, and I say, I notice you still got some expired. You know, at the time, you just put the little piece of paper on there, and you drive around with that. I say, you're going to get caught. I go, I'm going to take the car back. And I say, but you know you're going to have to still pay so much.
Yeah.
Well, I don't understand that. That's what you're going to understand. Well, I repented of it. I said, well, I understand that. Well, how come God will forgive me for that? I say, he forgive you for that.
Yeah.
But I still got to pay. Yeah. Y'all think I'm joking. It sounds like it's a joke, right? You'd be surprised at some of the stuff that come across my desk. And these are the same kind of people who I say, you know, you need to come to discipleship class. I don't need discipleship class. You need to come to some of the financial seminars we're doing. I don't need to come to nothing like that. And this is what we get. On three, I want you to read this one. One, two, three, read.
God has closed heaven.
How many of y'all have ever heard that before?
Yeah.
Some of y'all used it. Now y'all want me to try to disprove it. I'm not going to try to disprove it. I'm going to ask you a question. Brother Holly, if I can tie my shoes, why would you tie my shoes if I can do it?
Amen.
But if I can't, you may assist me or help me, right? Why is it that we believe that if we can do something, you know, for example, if I can't, okay, let's say, here's the building. Let's say we want to pay off this building. I can't do it. So, in other words, if I could do it, then that's the only time God will help me because I can do it. Did that make sense?
No.
This is what I teach, that God will do what you can't do, not what you can do. So God raises us up to do things that we can do, and then he'll say, the things that you cannot do, now I'm here. That's why so many people, that their finances are all messed up. And they have been trying to get their finances together for years, and they believe in God. Lord, I just believe you for this. I just believe. And someone will say, here, let me tell you, here's what we can do. We can show you how to start budgeting. We can show you how to do certain things, how to become more financially literate. We can teach you how to do certain things. We can teach you how to do this, how to do that. But you know what most people do? They don't have time for that. But if you do a miracle money, and people will pack the place up. Because somehow we have this thing that we're going to get God to do it, and we are not going to have to do anything. Because after all, God got all this, why don't we just give it to him? And I'm saying that's not the way God operates. Well, why is that? Come out for discipleship class. Oh, well, we got time for that. Do I have any more? Oh, I got another one. Y'all ever heard this? Clothes make the man. How many of y'all believe it? You mean to tell me that if I got on certain clothes, that's who I am. If I put on another kind of clothes, that's who I am. If I don't wear no clothes, that's who I am. You understand what I'm saying? Some things that we say, does it make sense? What about this one? On three, read it. One, two, three, three. Where did that come from?
The older generation.
Huh?
The older generation.
And that's passed down. Children should be seen and not heard. Can I say something on a little more of a serious note? What about when these children are being molested by some pervert? And they want to come and talk to you, or the school teacher, or somebody who in contact with them all the time, and they're being molested. And they want to come and talk to you. Children should be seen and not heard. Because we make them say that their voice is not important. Where did they come from? If we read in our Bibles, Jesus had a high regard for children. When the disciples tried to push the children away and said, you know, no, Jesus said, leave these children alone. Don't forbid them to come unto me. He said, for such is the kingdom of God. He said, and unless you receive one of these, you have not have no part in the kingdom of God. Unless you receive the gospel as a child. Not childish, childlike. See, we use cliches, and so we have a barrier. Folks, these are barriers that keep us from going forward, keep us from unifying. Until we all come together in agreement with the word of God and let God's word have the final say-so. Yesterday at the marriage fellowship, and the title was Marriage on the Rocks. Now, I can use that two ways. I can use that as marriage going bad. You know how you used to say marriage on the rock, which is a cliche? But also, have your marriage founded on the rock, which is the word of God. And I look at that, that if you are not, if your life is not stable in the word of God, then you're going to be tossed about with every cliche, every tradition, because you have no stability. It'll change every time your situation changes. Yeah. But when you are in the word of God, I don't care what happens, whatever going on in your life, your stability comes from the word of God, which changes not. God never changes his opinion. He never changes what he said. What he said over 2,000 years ago is still the same. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so instead of going around trying to find out what this person said, what Oprah said, what that person wrote, what this person said, you know what I said? Well, what did God say? So that's all that matters. I've heard people change their thoughts, but not God. When God puts something in an order, it doesn't change. Let me ask you a question. How many times have you ever got up in the morning and the sun rose in the west? When God set the order, it's not going to change. He does that. This is his creation. We only come into this creation, and we come into this creation not knowing anything. And you heard of people who were living before us, maybe they didn't know anything. And God said, I'm going to give you instructions on how to be victorious in this life. And we won't even read his instruction book. And so we have passed information down from generation to generation, from generation to generation, from generation to generation. And if it's wrong, we are sowing ignorance. It's going to seed, and then it comes up. I don't know what's wrong with these children today. You are. They got it from you.
Yes.
I mean, y'all have heard this before. An apple a day. How many of y'all have heard it? Well, you know, an apple a day keeps the doctor away. I ain't got time for that. On three, read this one. One, two, three, read.
Good things come to those who wait.
And there are a lot, again, not you all, but there are a lot of lazy people that live by this. Because, well, I'm going to just wait on the Lord. I'm waiting on God. When you going to get you a job? Well, I'm waiting on God. Well, I believe God has a job with my name on it. I believe God, well, when are you going to go get it? When are you going to go look for it? I'm waiting on the Lord. I don't do nothing until God tells me, until God motivates me. I don't move until, I know you don't move, but I don't do nothing unless God tells me. And I hear people saying that. And I said, you know, I want to, like I said, one day I want to cut loose. I just want to cut loose and repent later. I'm saying, y'all think I'm joking, but I'm tired. I just want to grab somebody and say, would you listen to what you just said? I can give you scripture on top of scripture on top of scripture on top of scripture on top of scripture that your understanding has been messed up. But if that's the way you want to live, you're going to justify it. Because somewhere in your mind, you feel like, well, see, now I can justify with not doing anything because, you know, good things come to those who wait. And I know the Lord said, I know the Bible says, wait on the Lord and be of good cheer. So I'm happy just waiting on the Lord. And everything around you, your children, your grandchildren, everybody else, just messed lives, all messed up. Well, I'm just waiting on the Lord. What about your children? I just turn them over and put them in the hands of the Lord. What about your spouse? You're going through issues with your husband, with your wife. Well, I already turned them over to the Lord. Well, when are you going to do so-and-so? What pastor I'm praying about? You hear all these are our Christian cliches or church cliches. I believe God working it out, Pastor. What are you doing? You mean to tell me you're going to sit on your chair and you're going to order God and God's going to work while you sit? We're going to dispatch angels to do stuff while we sit. And we believe that God's going to do it. We actually somehow have convinced ourselves that God is going to do all this for us. Because after all, he's our servant. Now, we have never said it, but that's what it sounds like. Read this on three. One, two, three. Ladies! And I told you about traditions. And here's another one I told you about. I shared this with you last week. You hear about people say, man, all you need is a hammer, a saw, or whatever, and a pair of pliers, and you can fix anything. Listen, folks, there are also many tools that were necessary in past generations that have become obsolete today. There are a lot of tools you can't use today because they're obsolete. They're unnecessary. So there are certain cliches, certain ways that we think that are no longer effective. And we can't use them anymore. Every tool that God has given us has been designed to perform specific tasks. Every tool. And we have to learn how to use those. That's why many of us still have the same old tools and we haven't upgraded to a different tool. Get you some more tools. And then learn how to use them. Don't get them just to show them off, but learn how to use the tools. Glory to God. Amen? It's time for us to stop using old traditional tools to complete our godly assignments. God has given us kingdom tools. Say kingdom tools.
Kingdom tools.
So we ought to use the kingdom tools for every task, and then you will start completing all of your God-given assignments. Listen, folks, I mentioned this to you before. Many traditions came into being because of necessity and environment. Yes. And I mentioned to you before how many times you hear certain things done, like I told you the order of black preacher, and it came out of slavery. Many of us have taken slavery, a culture, we've made our slavery experiences, and we've become a culture. And we say, well, this is what black folks do. This is the way we are. You know, like, tell me, how many of y'all can tell me what this means? CP time, what that mean? What the heck did it mean? And we justify it. So what time are you supposed to pick me up? I'll be there at 7, then at 7:15, 7:20. Well, you know, man, well, we know how we are, man. You know how we are. We don't see CP time. And we justify it. And people have gone out of business. People of color have gone out of business because they get businesses and they get nice places, beauty salons and hair, barber shops and stuff. And they got 9 o'clock on the door. And they get in there about 9:30. And I used to go to a barber shop. You know that was a long time ago, right? And I used to be the first one there. And I used to wonder, he come in, he can't cut my hair because he's cleaning up hair from yesterday. Why the heck did you do that before you went home? Why should I come into a dirty shop? I have to sit for 15, 20 minutes, wait on you to clean up hair that ain't even mine. You got me sit up back there. I want you all to see something from my past mentor who have passed and a good friend of ours who was his pastor. And I want you to listen to this real carefully. Now, listen to me. Everybody look at me. Okay? We're not serving popcorn. This is not nap time. I want you to hear this and hear it clearly. Okay, I'm ready.
I believe, Matt, there's a sign that God is about to do something that no one can stop.
Amen.
And God is doing some things with no one's permission.
Come on.
Anybody's.
Absolutely. And you know, there's a statement in the Bible that I think describes what's happening in our world right now.
Okay.
The story of Samson is a well-known story, but there's a verse in that entire story where Samson killed 1,000 Philistines. That statement changed my life, and it's about generations. It says that when Samson was out in the desert one day, 1,000 soldiers came up against him to kill him. Samson had no weapons or nothing. And then Samson saw in the sand a dry jawbone of a donkey.
Yeah.
Samson went over, picked up the jawbone, he shook off the sand, took a deep breath, and he moved toward the 1,000 soldiers. And Samson began to work. And every time he swung, someone fell. There was blood everywhere, I'm sure. And that white jawbone of a donkey turned soaked red. And the Bible says that when Samson was finished, there was 1,000 soldiers dead on the desert sand. He was the only one standing breathing. But that's not the part that changed my life. What changed my life, it says that afterwards, now don't forget this statement, very important statement. It says, then Samson threw away the jawbone. Now that's an important statement, because anytime something worked, we like to keep it.
Come on. Come on.
You know, if Samson had used the jawbone in 2006, 2005, in our generation, when something works, what we do with it, the first thing we do is we patent it.
Oh, man.
And then after we patent it, we begin to merchandise it, manufacture it, and we begin to trade it. In other words, we begin to sell it. And could you imagine Samson calling it Samsonite? The weapon.
Yeah.
And he could have sold this jawbone as a military weapon that worked. It actually worked. It killed 1,000 men. So he could have actually said on the package, killed 1,000 Philistines. And he could have traded it. Everybody say trade.
Trade.
Say it again, trade.
Trade.
See, whenever you take something and you package it and you trade it, it is called tradition. A tradition is something that worked, it was good,
yes.
It was effective, but when you finish with it, you gotta throw it away.
Okay.
I believe what happens is sometimes one generation that experienced a certain anointing of God try to trade it to the next generation.
Come on.
But they forget that the anointing was not in the jawbone, it was on the jawbone. Yeah. And when the anointing leaves the jawbone, you gotta throw the jawbone away. God's gonna use some things in our generation that he didn't use in our parents' generation. And we gotta remember to tell our parents, we gotta throw some things away, not because it was bad, but the anointing has left it. Don't ever get caught with what God used to use.
Come on.
The reason why many of us, we pass down things that is called traditional, and it may have been necessary at a certain point, at a certain time, but it's no longer necessary. So I want to close out today, because I have to do another part with this, and I'm going to talk about tradition. I'm going to talk about how Jesus dealt with tradition. But I mentioned this to you before, and you're probably going to get tired of hearing it, but I want to say to us, especially people of color, here's what our issues are. We have taken something that should be shameful, and we have made it a part of our culture, and we celebrate it. That was because people had to survive back in those days. When they had to eat, I mentioned this before, and Laverne made sure I saw some on Facebook. But chitlins, again, if that's your choice, I'm not. Go ahead and eat whatever. Hog maws, a lot of stuff that was thrown out and really become unhealthy for human consumption. But we eat that stuff. And we celebrate, especially around certain holidays. And we want to know why our culture deals with a lot of hypertension, heart disease, high cholesterol, all this other stuff, that these certain bad habits that we have taken and made a tradition, and not realizing that a lot of that stuff comes from poor diets. And there are certain things that we have brought into even this generation. And like I mentioned earlier, the art of black preaching, And I mentioned to you, listen real carefully, you all, this is important. I know that some people love that. If I did that, I could fill the church up. But it's like a lot of emotional preaching, because in our mindset, we believe that's what church is all about. We think emotions is inspiration. And we think that if we can get people to jump and to shout and to dance and all of that, we feel like that's the spirit of the Lord. However, the biggest problem is that no one can show me anywhere in the gospel where they can even imagine Jesus doing it. But it's hard to let go of something that we really want, that we really enjoy. And so a lot of people enjoy it, and we have gone to a service before where, I mean, it was somebody, all of a sudden the music was playing, and, you know, they had pews. And this person behind me, behind Cheryl and I, and they started bumping. And I had to lean up, Cheryl, and hit me in the head. Now, if someone tells me, well, Pastor, that's the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit, if that's the Spirit, you ain't going to get hurt.
Amen.
And I've seen people get hurt before. I've seen it happen. So, all of the bucket, all of that, and it's out of control. And then when people go home, they go into the same situation. They go into the same, then nothing changed at home. And they didn't change, but they got a spiritual fix. I call it a spiritual placebo. How many of y'all don't know what a placebo is? How many of y'all don't know and don't want to admit you don't know what a placebo is? All of y'all know what a placebo is. If I ask you what a placebo is, if I come to you and say, what is the placebo, you would tell me, right? So, how many of y'all can say, you can pick me out, Jenny? See, that's what I'm saying. A placebo is pretty much, it gives you like what doctors would do. Doctors would give you like sugar pills. And had no medicinal purpose. And it fooled the people into believing that this thing worked. And so what happens is that back in the days of slavery, black people were not permitted to read and write. So when the preacher would preach, he had to be that kind of preacher that would inspire, because people had all kind of stuff going on in their lives. And they could not promise anything about tomorrow, so everything had to be about heaven. When we get to heaven, we're going to see our loved one that got sold off in slavery. We're going to see that little baby that they took and whatever they deal with. We're going to see where the master mistress or his wife didn't have any children. So he served a child by raping one of the women, and then they took them as their own and took this woman's child. I mean, so they can't get mad in public, so they vic. And they get so frustrated at church because they said, we let you have Sunday. And all the other stuff, these women saw their husbands beat men, and see their wives raped, and see their children mistreated, and see them one. And so the preacher would come out on Sunday, and boy, he would preach, and he didn't read the Bible because he couldn't read. So he would memorize some scriptures and stuff, and what he would do, he would preach in such a way where those people would start jumping and shouting, not out of joy, because that's just a way of expressing their hurt, their pain, their all the stuff they was going through. And they would fall on the floor. And the whole message was that one day you're gonna see mama, and you're gonna see your daddy. I know you was a baby when they took him in, but you're gonna see him again in heaven, child. And so heaven became the focus. Because there was no real hope in their lives for the next day. The churches have, black churches have passed that down from generation to generation to generation. So when we come to church, and the reason why a lot of us, again, I'm not knocking this, but the reason why we are expected to dress up on Sundays is because back then, when people were, you go back to the Jim Crow days, listen to me. You didn't have too many places you can go to dress up. So you didn't go to the clubs if you got saved. You didn't go to the juke joints or whatever they call it. You didn't go to these little places. So now you didn't really have too many places to go, but you had a nice, yes, you're able to get some nice clothes. So those became what we call
church clothes.
And so it became so traditional that you can't go to church unless you have this on. So it was passed down. No, you've got to have a suit on. You've got to have a dress on. You can't, no, you can't go to church with that on. Why not? You're going into the house of the Lord. But God doesn't dwell in the building. He dwells in us. Well, you can't wear pants, women. You can't wear. So all of a sudden, the outer person became the focus. So you can start looking like something, even if nothing takes place on the inside. And that's why a lot of us, we actually don't care if nothing gets done in our lives, on our jobs, in our communities, just long as we can get this placebo. We got our fix. Hoping to carry us to another 7 days. And so here I'm telling you, and I'm sharing with you, many scriptures, and unless you are a doer of the word, you're deceiving yourself. You are here only. And we know that. But so many of us walk out of here, and somehow we think, well, I don't know why God haven't worked in my life. I don't know why things haven't changed. I went to church, and I prayed. And I said, well, you did the right thing, but what did you do after you prayed, when you got up? Even the pastor laid hands on me. Well, that's good, but you may have fallen on the floor under the power of the Holy Ghost, but you had to get up. What did you do different? If you didn't learn anything different, you're not going to do anything different. And so the scripture says, if you keep sowing the same seed, you'll get the same harvest. Be not deceived. God did not mock. The people of Israel could not go into the promised land when God sent out the 12 spies. Joshua and Caleb qualified because they was tired of the wilderness and they was fed up with what happened back in Egypt. Some of us have brought Egypt with us. Everywhere we go, we bring Egypt with us. And you have a few people that say, I didn't like it when I was in the world. I didn't like that. That's why I left it. I didn't want no parts of it. But some of us, we bring in some of those same old tools. And somehow think that those tools that we used in the world will work in the kingdom. And so we keep trying. That's why we fuss at our children in such a way where we go off on them, thinking that's going to change them. But it didn't work for you. I'm going to beat the devil out of them. Your parents could not beat the devil out of them. All they did was they was able to make you act a certain way in their presence. But when they wasn't around you, you didn't even know. So we have become good at teaching people how to act. You don't act that way in church. That's a cliche. One lady one time was bringing her daughter to church, and I looked, and I kind of didn't say nothing. And she said, I told her not to wear that to church. I say, so where is it permitted for her to work? I mean, it was revealing everything. I said, so where is it permitted for her to worry? Is it bad to wear in church, or is it bad to wear? Is it improper dressing for a young lady, or is it improper only in the church? But in the world, it's okay. In the club, it's okay. Just don't wear to church. That's religion. And what I'm saying is, I'm not trying to make this life where it's hard. I'm saying, if we're going to live this life, that's the least benefit from it. Don't that make sense? And that's what my job is. That's what I do. I'm trying to show you, this is how this works. All of the emotions is not going to make a difference unless you change your thinking. Instead of keep passing these traditions down, it doesn't work. Miles, throw them away. It may have worked in one generation. It was necessary, the kind of preaching I was just talking about, it was necessary the other night. It was very necessary. It fit its purpose. God has a way of saying, okay, I'm going to use this so that the people will not perish. But the time is going to come where that brook is going to dry up. And we keep going back, and we're coming back, we go, and we try to drink, and we leave there just as thirsty as when we first went. We go to churches many times, and we get this little emotion, but we go, and we're still just as dry. Our marriages are dry. Our relationships are dry. Finances are drying up. And yet we serve a God who say, come, let us reason together. If you be willing and obedient, you should eat the good of the land. If you're willing and what?
Obedient.
And that's a consistency. We need to learn. We had a new kingdom, new tools. Those traditions, my daddy gave me so many traditions, I threw those things in the trash. It didn't take me long to start throwing that stuff in the trash. It wasn't working for him. I mean, seriously, why would I use something, some tools that is not working for you, brother? So, I want to share next week, I want to talk about how Jesus, how he felt about traditions. And I won't go over all this like I did before. Some of the things we talked about, I brought some humor in it, different traditional cliches. But some people actually, their lives are patterned back to certain things. And I'm saying, folks, it's time for us to learn how to use the tools that God has given us. Amen?
Amen.
Please stand.